दिस इज इंग्लिश शॉर्ट हैंड डिक्टेशन नंबर 78 एंड द डिक्टेशन स्पीड इज 120 वर्ड्स पर मिनट. रेडी स्टार्ट. मिस्टर प्रेसिडेंट सर, आई हैव कम फॉरवर्ड टू सपोर्ट द रेजोल्यूशन एंड आई वुड एड दैट आई हैव कम फॉरवर्ड टू अर्ज विद ऑल द स्ट्रेंथ इन माई पावर that this resolution be pushed to its conclusion at these sittings. I have considered with very great care that all my colleagues have said in support of this amendment, proposing an adjournment of this discussion until the representatives of the Muslim League and the representatives of the Indian states have joined us. There is only one compliment I have to make against this motion for adjournment. I think that it lacks imagination. I say so without disrespect to my friends. I say it lacks imagination because it forgets that we have just launched ourselves on a very big task, and it is necessary that we should impress our country and the world that we mean business. Now, sir, look at this resolution. It is a resolution which sets out the objectives that we have to place before ourselves in framing our constitution. Is such resolution to be postponed till we reach the last stage of our work in this assembly? Is it not a resolution which must preface everything that we propose to do in this assembly? I think that is a complete answer to this motion for adjournment. The mover and supporters of the amendment have urged reasons for postponing the consideration of this resolution. But in doing so, they have themselves admitted that there is nothing in this resolution to which either of them is prepared to take exception. I appeal to them that if they believe in this resolution, they must pass it at this series of sittings and before we commence real business, and not postpone it till we have practically completed all our business. My honorable friend, towards the close of his speech, suggested that the consideration of this resolution might be postponed only for about a month or so, by the end of which he hoped that the representatives of the Muslim League would have joined us. But what about the representatives of the Indian states? For no fault of this Constituent Assembly, the representatives of the Indian states have not come into this Assembly at the start, as I consider it is their right to do. But the procedure has been so regulated that they come in only at the final sitting of this Constituent Assembly. Are we to wait for them? After all, the most vocal objection to this resolution that has come from outside this house has come from people who represent the Indian states. Now, taking the representatives of the Muslim League themselves, are we doing any injustice to them in proceeding with this resolution? Their main objection to what we are doing today is the different interpretation they have put upon the clause relating to grouping. We are not discussing grouping. We are discussing this resolution which lays down the objectives of our work, a matter in respect of which they have a perfect right to come and participate in this debate. What prevents them from coming and taking their seats here and debating with us here the other questions that we are taking up as a preliminary to the more important work that will follow? their main objection will arise only when this assembly, towards the end of the first session, proposes to split into sections. And as I shall show in a minute, sir, it is quite possible for them to arise all the issues that they want to raise at that stage. Sir, the question as regards grouping has entered a new phase with the statement made by His Majesty's government on the 6th of this month, but I would not go into the merits of what they have said in that statement. The only thing I would say is that it is a most astonishing statement to be made by so august a body as His Majesty's government at this stage of the controversy. Be that as it may, I do not intend to go into its merits. Of course, it is not within the jurisdiction of His Majesty's government to say whether they would accept the federal court's view or whether they would not, because it is entirely out of their hands. The Constituent Assembly makes the reference to the federal court, and it is for the Constituent Assembly to say before it makes the reference that it will abide by the decision of the federal court. What will happen then? Assuming that the federal court's decision is in favor of the view taken by His Majesty's government, what will be the position of those who have taken a contrary view? The only thing they can do in view of all the commitments they have made to individual provinces and communities is to move this assembly for a modification of paragraph 19, which would more clearly express their view. The main difficulty is the method of voting in the sections, as the Secretary of State said in the House of Lords. If you leave paragraph 19 as it is certainly an arguable point that in the absence of any modification of the wording of that clause, the voting must be by individuals and a simple majority would decide the question. It is certainly an arguable point. If we want that voting should be by provinces, it is necessary that we should propose a modification of that clause, and that modification can be done by this assembly on a motion properly made. Now, are we going to do that? I suggest that, in view of what has come from His Majesty's government, both in the statement of December the 6th and in the speeches made in the two houses of Parliament, the wiser thing to do is not to send a reference to the federal court, but to take the other course which I have indicated. That is, you bring up a resolution in this Constituent Assembly proposing a modification of Clause 19, which will provide that the method of voting should be by provinces in the sections so far as the grouping matter is concerned. The resolution I am suggesting is to be moved in this assembly, and we are to take a decision on it. It is quite possible, and I think it would be an arguable position for the Muslim League representatives to come here and raise the question that such a modification involves a major communal issue. If you decide that it is a major communal issue, or if, after obtaining the advice of the federal court, you decide that it involves a major communal issue, it will be open to the Muslim League to contend that you cannot carry out that modification without a majority of each of the major communities. Why should we not take that step? We shall take that resolution into consideration at an adjourned sitting of this assembly. That must be a sufficient indication to the members of the Muslim League to come and occupy their places in this assembly and defeat what they consider to be an unconscionable suggestion from the other side.